Good day and welcome to The Conversation. Today I'm privileged to host the former Minister of Home Affairs and Shwangandu Member of Parliament. He's also a member of the Central Committee of the Patriotic Front, Honourable Stephen Shwangandu. Vanemu aiseni.
It's indeed a pleasure to be on this platform, which is, I think, for me, is a very a good innovation. And yeah. Kudos to you. I mean, as they say, veterans in the game of communication.
M-quai.
Embrace innovations.
Yes.
Kaishi ni stuwamo na mchiri murenda na neishuku. Because, as they say, old wine
yes,
it gets
yes.
just as better. Like I always joke with old Frank.
Ambassador Frank
Mtuila. Ambassador Frank Mtuila. You know, he's a Chinsarian. And you know, an interesting...
Son of a reverend.
You know, his firstborn child, Isaac, is a very good friend of mine. We get along. But I just enjoy the way he's evolving. The age is catching up.
Yeah,
and you're following the footsteps.
Thank you very much. We witnessed a very tumultuous year last year in the democratic space. There's now broad consensus that there is a shrinking democratic space. The Zambia Conference of Catholic Bishops aired their concerns, you know, accused the president of not allowing political rallies, shrinking freedoms of rights and freedoms of people. The Evangelical Fellowship of Zambia, another church grouping, also raised similar concerns, especially that time with the happenings around the Patriotic Front. The Council of Churches in Zambia, CCZ, also raised the same concerns. The Law Association of Zambia have also raised the same concerns. The reaction from the UPND has been that, no, what are you talking about? The PF was worse. The PF was violent. The PF didn't allow rallies. You were charged with a very sensitive portfolio. As Minister of Home Affairs, we're privileged. I think you're one of those longest serving ministers of Home Affairs. Just speak to those issues and why people are saying they're shrinking democratic space while the UPND think that we were worse.
Thank you so much, my brother, for bringing up that very interesting topical issue. And I want to say this, that we who are privileged to be leaders must learn to understand all the time that the authority that we thrive on is people's given. It's people's authority.
Yeah.
It's not ours. And I think many times when we are in top authority, government, I don't know probably what happens to us. And I'm saying this without being malicious.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you tend to forget and get carried away with that authority. And you slowly start forgetting where it comes from.
It comes from the
so
people.
The moment we start appreciating that aspect, I think then democracy will grow without encumbrances. The institutions that you have referred to, the stakeholders that you have referred to, the church mother bodies, Law Association of Zambia, among others, should be treated as mirrors of society. Because a mirror will just reflect what it has captured. So if you are the image captured by the mirror being reflected, you must ask yourself, let's say you have got a wrinkled face, you have just been, you know, scratched. And the mirror shows you when you go in front of it.
Mm. You can't say the mirror is lying.
You can't say the mirror is lying. It will just show you. So it's saying, go and do something if you want to go out there and look like a normal person.
Mm.
So you go and deal with the face and comb your hair properly. Then you come out. When you go and you want it to show you what it's recapturing, because it's in your mind that you want it to look, you are already looking good. If you don't want to be to munshewa, So what I'm trying to say is that there is what would be the benefit for the church mother bodies to
raise concerns
about government when there are no concerns. What would be the reason? So these are questions that you need to ask. And then if you are the one that is being reflected, the mirror showed you that you have got, and then you are trying to say, this mirror is defective. Break it. Go to the next one. It shows you the same thing.
You break it. The mirror.
How many mirrors are you going to break before you get to fix yourself? Okay, so you can deal with all these stakeholders, change mother bodies to hell, lower association of Zambia to hell.
Does the problem
other
go
stakeholders
away?
To hell?
The
problem won't go away, it will just get worse. And the fact that time will be ticking, there will be time to come and be held accountable. Mind you, like I said, the authority that we go with in government is people given. So whether you hit yourself on the chest and say, no, for us, to hell with the church, we know what we're doing. The people that gave you the authority will be waiting. At that point, they might look helpless. But they wait at an opportune time. They may look docile, as sometimes people say Zambians are docile.
Yeah.
But the fact that they've changed government now the third time should show you that people are becoming knowledgeable, whether they are educated or not, they are becoming to appreciate their right and their authority. So when they are saying, it sounds as if they are teasing you, but it's now happening. Speaking about MPs, for example, you have seen the turnover of MPs. There are very few of us, Mr. Mwamba, who could say we have been privileged to go the third time. It's not easy. The factors are so many. Sometimes our colleagues are judged by the people, are misjudged. You understand? So there are so many things that are going on.
Citizens are becoming very active.
Exactly. Sometimes they even make mistakes. You know, by misjudging a person who could have meant well for them, they end up with the worst. So these are things that I think we need to reflect on. So when you say the democratic space is shrinking and many stakeholders have spoken to that, you can't, there's nothing that I can add or subtract, but just to reaffirm what many stakeholders have expressed. And, you know, when to compare what PF record was and the... It doesn't make a situation any better. So if
the Inspector General of Police, and you've guided him before, you've made remarks, has repeatedly refused for the opposition to have political rallies, to have, you know, open-air meetings. And many stakeholders have come to the conclusion that the current Inspector General of Police is literally now a danger to our democracy, because it doesn't want citizens to exercise their rights.
Yeah,
you had several IGs save government, save the president through you as Minister of Home Affairs. What was your guidance? Did you stop political rallies? How did, for example, opposition leader President Akainde Hichilema hold those meetings and those political rallies?
Ambassador, before I even get to the Inspector General, in concluding the aspect of the shrinking democratic space, it all boils down to the head of state, the one that has got the mandate to run this country. Because he's the commander-in-chief. The person we are talking to, talking about, is the inspector general.
He's an appointee.
He's an appointee. You understand? So if the inspector general has seen the tone from his commander-in-chief, he is probably just towing the line. You understand? So it all goes back to what the head of state wants to achieve. He was in opposition himself before, and he was made to, he managed to get into government. So to try and compare Patriot Front and themselves would not be fair. Because at the end of the day, if it was that bad, probably he couldn't be sitting in State House today. But you recall that even during the COVID, at the height of COVID, their leadership came to engage myself as Minister of Home Affairs then and the Inspector General on the modalities of how they were going to head to hold their conference to choose their national management committees and their provincial leadership. We had to find a modality of them to do that.
You cooperated with them.
We worked together. They came and they made presentations through their leadership. Honorable Jack Mwimbu then and Honorable Garin Kombo was part of that team, Mr. Stephen Katuka, and many other leaders. They came to make presentations. This is how we wanted to do it, because we can't...
We do not want to breach so COVID regulations.
That shows you how much of cooperation was there. And, you know, like the other time I was saying, you know, sometimes we don't learn. You know, sometimes you want to come and throw the
baby with the bathwater.
The lady who has been victimized, and I'm happy that the nation have been able to see that this professional civil servant in the name of restore societies who manages
Madame
societies, because it also comes back to the same democratic space that we're talking about.
Yes.
Her role is to regulate societies. And as you know, political parties are not exclusively provided for in our registration. And the act that the Restore Societies uses to administer and to regulate societies, including political parties, is a Cap 119 of the Laws of Zambia, Legislative of Societies Act. So this act does not provide exclusive for political parties. So what happens, Mr. Ambassador, if you want to form a political party, you will have to come up with your constitution.
Or she regulates, or that office regulates all societies.
All societies.
From churches, NGOs, to political parties.
Exactly, including political parties. But the churches and other non-government organizations are all provided for. Like I'm saying, political parties are the ones that are not exclusive, especially after the reintroduction of multi-party politics. So what the Register of Societies does is to interpret political party constitutions read together with the act.
Law.
You understand? So you cannot go and prevail on her to ignore the laid down
procedures and the provision of that constitution of that society.
Exactly. Exactly. And we are supposed to be in the process of anyway coming up with political parties
act.
A bill which then can culminate into an act so that it directly speaks regulates and operationalizes some parts of Article 60 of the Constitution. You know, so that's a topic for another day. I think we may need time.
No, the issue of the issue of the Registrar of Societies was under your office.
Yes,
and we saw UPND claim that you know, your office also interfered with the registrar in relation to some political parties then.
I would tell you something, Mr. Ambassador, that professional, having worked with her and a few others, is a lady of substance and she understood her job. And you know, she handled so many political party disputes. NDC,
mm.
And many others,
mm.
where there were disputes, should just say, go to court.
Mm.
Once the court determines, then you come
implement.
Back. Mm. I've heard people talk about MMD. Mm. MMD,
mm.
The in-house arrangements of the conferences,
mm.
you never saw Mr. Mutati, and he's still alive. You can speak to him. You never saw Mr. Mutati being escorted by police
mm.
to go and have a retreat.
Mm-hmm.
They went to a convention and, you know, Mr.
Today, you know, we saw a large number of police deployment at Radisson Blue, where our dear brother was having a meeting. We never saw that opposition guarded in the manner that they are guarding, you know, our dear brother, the stooge there.
Again, that goes to show you that there's something serious and there's something wrong.
Mm.
How many political parties do we have?
Mm. Mm.
Hari Kalawa is a leader of a political party.
Mm.
So is Mr. Fred Membe.
Mm.
My brother, Mr. Winter Kabimba, who I saw visiting community house the other day, is a political party. I've never seen him with police.
Yeah.
Wherever he holds his gatherings, there's no police.
Mm.
So some of these things... You know, sometimes I've always said, Mr. Ambassador, you have veteran civil servant yourself,
yeah.
and you have been on the international, you know, you have been in other jurisdictions.
Mm.
Statecraft is used by all governments.
Yeah.
But governments should not be reckless with the way they use statecraft. Statecraft should be used for the common good of citizens.
Mm.
But the moment you start misapplying statecraft and start disadvantaging citizens, a certain class of citizens, then it becomes abuse of authority.
Mm.
And this is what we are seeing.
It's a clear
abuse of authority.
Mm.
And some people will be made to account for that.
One day.
You know, it's important. When you are swimming in authority, sometimes you don't see these things.
Mm.
But time comes. There's, I mean, these are tours of duty.
Yeah.
Whether you like it or not,
it's
a tour of duty that will begin from one point and end at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you like it or not.
Yeah. It's better to do the right thing.
People
have
been tempted to increase the terms of offices, but a tour of duty will come to an end.
Mm.
And that's the interest of democracy.
Yeah.
And like I said, people would look to be docile when they are watching you do some of these illegalities.
Mm-hmm.
But time comes.
Mm-hmm.
Time comes. Mm-hmm. And like I've said, our colleagues in government today are not the first.
Mm.
You know, we had UNIP.
Yeah.
And I think we are yet to have a leader who will be as strong as Dr.
Kaunda.
So we all must understand and appreciate that when we are given an opportunity by the citizens of this country, it should appeal to your mind that I'm not the first, neither am I going to be the last.
Mm.
And so, you know, my plea to those in the authority now is just understand that whatever you say to others will be the same measure that could be used against you. And so it's not like to threaten them. Who thought we could be here, Mr. Mwamba?
Mm.
Eh? We thought, no, the Zambians will still give us another mandate.
Yeah.
But here we are.
We are in opposition.
Yes. We shouldn't regret, but that's the nature of democracy. Mm. And even our colleagues have heard them say, no, we go beyond so much and what not.
Mm.
And you're looking at their performance. Yes, it's allowed. You can, you know, tumwa ilumba, mwaichapa fifupa tuke kala, umuya yaya, chan. But time will come. So let them just focus on doing what people expect them to do. Mind you, there's a catalogue of promises that people of Zambia are still looking at. And you know, now we're in the digital age.
Yeah.
Mwamba wesu. Kaishi nangufeni kafoni, umuntu aisa kemia, aisa mwana kafiwe kanina, aisa imia kafoni, aisa wekela mtu madates, aisa wikisha, aisa mwana wakateka walipari kapampu, waleso ntomute ngowa fiwe ukwa jinenga na ingina.
Mkabwa
single digit. So, apatuli, tetuanga shena avantu. And for those of you who are in government, You may think when people are asking about these things, it won't matter. Mm. It will certainly matter.
Mm.
So I will come to that issue of promises later on.
Yeah.
But in getting to the police inspector general, like I said, it's all about top leadership. You understand?
Yes.
So if you know that you can misconduct yourself
and get away
and get away with it, and your leaders don't see anything wrong to reprimand you, you can just go to the moon. But like I've always said to him, it's not that I've got anything against him personally.
No, you are very right.
I didn't have an opportunity to work with him. So it shows you how long he has been away from the service. You understand? You know, even the book which has been in the shelf for a long time, you can dust it up, and you know, sometimes you think dust has finished. Just as you are flipping the pages, you choke up. So I know that when I Inspector General of Police, kale mwafumine muri bo police. Epo na ina issue adimbina.
In 2010.
2010. But that's 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you this. We have a report at Parliament, which is a parliamentary report from the committee responsible for security and foreign affairs, which went to look at the matters of the police service in last session. It brought out serious issues which were debated on the floor.
Wow.
How does the police were given free? Because you know, when they are given immunity by the committee, they are free to express themselves. They spoke, first of all, of their displeasure. Because you see, they all, you know, these people in uniforms, if there's something
their career, policemen,
their
career
motivation
professionals.
Is, oh, now
you rise,
you excel, you rise, and you must, you know, that's what gives them pride. How you are dressed up on the shoulders, and you are capacitated. Now, if you start putting prospects
down
on other ranks and say, look, you can't proceed. It's here. We are going to get those that have worked before.
The retirees.
What are you doing to the service? So first of all, me have had a problem, and the committee of parliament found that problem. Because officers expressed themselves. They said they've got so many vibrant,
they are demotivated,
young men and women who could talk up these jobs. Yes, you can plug one from the retired to just say, you know, for, you know, if you so much want the institutional memory, one or two, one is acceptable, but not where you go and
do the entire command.
Now, that for me, not that I'm against anyone personally, it doesn't fly.
Yeah.
And it doesn't fly for the systems. You are stifling the systems. Imagine.
Career growth.
Exactly.
And motivation in the service.
You can understand. You know, he has to praise the masters. You know, you have been sleeping, you have tired, then you are brought into service. What else can you do apart from just praising the one that has said, come back?
No innovation.
Well,
no,
just
nothing.
A pa here. So you start seeing others as junks, but what do they see in you? Just as you are seeing them as junks, junkies. They also think you may be, you know.
Oh, those remarks by the IG are very unfortunate.
Very demotivating.
You
very
cannot
motivating.
Say they are junkies in the police. You
not
cannot
at all,
say that.
Because you see, every government.
That is your staff. They reflect who you are.
Bamamba, recruitment of public service is routine for every government. So every government that will form government will supervise recruitment and make sure that they continue, because the population is growing. So you have to continue matching the ratio between the services of Zambia Police, for example, and the public.
And also,
so
the purpose of recruitment, the purpose of recruitment is, first, number one, you replace those that were deceased in the year. Those are retired.
And retired, not bringing back retired.
Yeah, exactly.
That's recruitment.
Those that could be in school, those that could have, you know, resigned. That's the purpose of recruitment.
And so like to take and place. Bringing fresh breed.
Yes.
Fresh
yes.
energy.
Yes.
You know, bodies, as you are growing up, you are getting tired. A police officer who could have served 30 years cannot be as effective as a police officer who was serving his first 5 years.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's important that you continue bridging. Now, not bringing back
the retired
prince. But my plea to the Inspector General is to appreciate that job, yes, appointed by the head of state, but it's a people's job. He has a responsibility.
They are creatures of the Constitution. The
exactly.
issue of the Inspector General of and Police is in the Constitution.
That's it.
They should be more loyal to the Constitution than to...
That's you know, it, than, to an individual.
Yeah.
Moreover, they are not, you know, being an Inspector General does not make you above the law.
No. No.
That you can do everything with impunity. You can be held accountable. And like I've guided before, just like we were there, we were not the first and last. Even those that are there, like I said again, it's tour of duty.
Yeah.
He's not the first Inspector General, neither is he going to be the last one. So he must desist the temptation of wanting to think that now he has become almighty. He can call and do this and everything, everybody should jump. The inspector said they didn't go and hide. No. When you cage people, there will come a time when they will say enough is enough. And that's not a desirable place to be. It's not a desirable place to be.
In fact, because you added issues of national security, the IMF in their 2022 report that was released in 2023 and the Economic Intelligence Unit have stated that the state of our country, because of economic conditions, legacy issues such as poverty and employment, the security situation is quite sensitive. In fact, they've predicted that there might be civil unrest or popular protests because of how the population is living. So I find it very strange that you have a government then that conducts itself in a careless manner to a citizenry that is literally at the brink of protest. You ban political rallies. You have an inspector general who disregards citizens. You have a government that talks over citizens and, you know, what is your reflection on those issues? Because you must have sat in those security clusters and dealt with issues like that.
It's interesting. Maybe before I speak about the issue of national security,
yeah,
I would like to say that the issue of public gatherings are subjected to the law.
Yeah.
You know, there is a law in place, the Public Order Act. In as much as it is called a cake and what, it does guide on what should be done. And I'm surprised that sometimes people are speaking to things that are not in the law.
Yeah.
You can't say you have to go and get a permit. All you do, Ambassador Mwamba, when you want to have a procession or a gathering, is to notify the police within a period of, you know, 7 days.
The police refuse to take that notice and tell
you
that you have a rally.
That's why they get dragged to court. You remember there was an interesting case that was taken to court by the junior doctors, which gave effect to some amendments to the Public Order Act. So it's just a misunderstanding. There's no need for a permit. It's a notification. And of course, the police, all they have to do is find out how the procession is going to be conducted, who is going to be marshals, and who is going to be responsible for what. And they provide security if there is need for that. Now,
the UPND Deputy Secretary General Batuke Menda, Gertrude Menda, said they will not allow the opposition to have rallies. We thought it was the UPND speaking. They could be in government, but they are not government. The same statement was repeated now by the Inspector General of Police, and he cited the issue of security concerns.
But again, it's just organized confusion. I can just describe it that way. It's organized confusion. The Madam Imenda, who is a former honorable member of parliament, and I worked with her quite closely because we were elected at the same time, although she only served for one term. Yeah, but She has got no mandate. She's a former lawmaker who should understand that being deputy secretary general of a political party, although in the ruling party, she has got no mandate to make government pronouncements, to even give directives to the police, and she can't stop anyone. The same rights that she has to enjoy are the same rights that Citizens First party should enjoy. Are the same rights that Patriot Front should enjoy. So her should understand the lane. This is where we say, keep your lane. You know, don't... but the organized confusion I've seen in the UPND, with the UPND, is that you don't know who is who. Who has got what mandate and what authority. Everybody can sit on the media platform and start making pronouncements. But that's very dangerous for the state, because they are now in government. They must distinguish part functionaries and government work. Those the ministers who are political party members.
And the utterances by the IG literally taking away rights of political
lawlessness.
Parties.
I cannot call it lawlessness, Mr. Ambassador Mwamba. That's lawlessness. And I've spoken about it, not that I've hidden. I've cautioned the Inspector General to say, please be law abiding. Making you an Inspector General of Police does not make you
above
an
the law.
Individual above the law. He must be guided. He must understand that whatever he decides must be within the confines of the law. That's what he's supposed to do. So he should understand that, yes, sometimes, you know, he wants to sensationalize, and when he wants to talk about the police service itself, sometimes you sit back and say, oh, my God, what has happened? You know? This is a person whose record shows that he was a professional police. But again, you know, I think the period he stayed from the service is too long. It's too long.
Ingala washa ingila.
Yeah, it's too long. I mean,
let's speak about.
It's understandable, but
let's speak about.
But he has to understand that security is a very complex matter. You can equip the police. You can equip all the security institutions. But security is such a very
fluid,
interesting component. There is a correlation between food security, for example, and national security. That's why you find that any security cluster must take an interest in what is obtaining insofar as food security is concerned.
That is why, for example, the IMF report and
that's where you are coming from.
Are referring
that's
to,
where that report is coming from. Because it's saying, where people have got hungry stomachs, you know, their minds do not think properly. You know, they become volatile. That's a person who never thought he could go and steal, they would just basically go and steal to just eat. Not that idea that someone is a criminal by nature. But food security has got everything to do with national security. That's why it's very important that these sectors are prioritized as such.
Even the mishandling of health security, for example, Idiashria cholera, these things have an impact on national security.
That's it, but food security, that's why you see, you know, when you start deploying in the borders to guard against smuggling, what are you saying? You are saying, let's make sure that we are food
first
secure.
Our people are food
so
secure.
So that people are safe. So that report you are talking about was looking at a wide range of issues. And the potential they are talking about is, you have seen people have already started queuing up for mini meal. And you see what goes on when people are queuing up for mini meal. It's not a pleasant thing.
No.
And
no.
These are things that we never anticipated we could see in this era.
No.
But if you reach Tikawa Mwamba, Ubunga Kanidi Radia Vantuari Tantamina.
Yo Kale, Mama 1990.
So, Fidia, if it is she, Now, quite a while, I didn't sell an aluminum, I So it's important that we prioritize matters that need attention of government.
Yeah.
Food security, number one.
Number one, top priority.
Then you can come to security. If you are giving people's liberties, I mean, if government is working with Mwamba, for example, nangwa isa ikalapano lela ndio kutira ya mkwa yunga na udula ya unga kurundazi ni 450 kwacha. Abantu isa tira hao kanshima Mwamba no mbana mfurungana. Nga kwa mwere chibunga ni mfuri mpantu kuna mwunga tulishita 50 kwacha.
Yeah.
Abantu wewa kukanya. Ukutia mwere wepa fiobufi. So, ngolefu kutira if wewa fikansa fiacha rotube ibi relevant. Kutira shani? Kukufi jobo. If you never say shake up power to Rukish, but that we should be equation of a bombay a few
euros.
It was 3 months.
No. In fact, all marketing companies are complaining and they are now literally taking the subsidy, the price of fuel that they are importing at, especially with the instability in the exchange rate, shows that the price of fuel should not be where it is. It's being massaged politically, but I don't know how long it will
be. It's a reality, and you can feel for the whole marketing companies.
Yeah,
but it's important that these matters are addressed because you know, tomorrow, Tengera Mafiam Chino,
Muchilona,
because Chris have can stay at
No, that's what it means to be shortage.
My brother Gary Nkombo. We were supposed to appear on one program, 5 FM. Zaki is our witness. My brother appeared on that platform, and I remember he was one of the longest serving chairpersons on the Committee of Energy.
Yeah,
and he was articulating very well. And in my view, he could have made a very good use of energy. He was assuring the nation that once the Tazama pipeline is cleaned up, that dead stock,
and they start pumping to carry finished products.
The Zambians were going to see the reduced prices of fuel. I told him it's not possible.
There are many factors.
And I dared him that we needed to go back after 3 months. And I'm waiting for Zach to invite us. So that we go and conclude that discussion.
Yeah.
Now, remember, the Chichiwombe, so it's not possible. You will just be moving diesel. In fact, you have a scandal. Pantu, that date stock, you have Fumine Mulamumu pipe. Ni one shipment, pumping away to our winding. That one for the first. It's a process. I was teaching one and in the Ramashaya quick. To I say one of our minister while canceling a contract. I teach of our present me a canyon. While I cancel a contract by hand, which is the worst form of abuse of authority.
A minister,
you know, the ministerial guidelines.
Yeah, never gets involved in issues of
procurement. You have been a controlling officer yourself.
The minister can never give a letter of award. The minister cannot cancel a contract.
Now, if people
we've only seen these issues now.
But if people are getting away with such scandals,
what
kind of governance do we have?
Those
are the questions.
Yeah.
Forget about these scandals of dollars on the table and kwacha. These are things that we spoke about. Because it was a meetup late to remember.
Yeah.
Apa koma ila nondo?
Ngao, nishpani ule.
Kairi wa kalema,
takale
ka.
And we saw it.
Imkwa impaka fipate uro nomba nko. Ifima sasarafia mangwe.
Ya, isha ifurila.
Isha ifurila. Eko ba istisha nyama maina, lebe wa mparlamenti. Sepo la reata mparlamenti antipo. Shako nombe fitu wala putuara istisha nyama maini. Kwa titule istisha nyembarala. Imi kuwa ya nomba tule istisha nyapa ya poti. Ndeke sharana, kura kuina kuya wakateka, ura nombe kurea makasha, madora. Banana Republic to the
true.
So, Vashimamba, our next dream was to take any chalo.
Never feel one.
Ero Kufiroa, Kuimone Kerafi. Timono, my chinaman, you catch into chaff, you know, I said, but you want to take 25 kg.
I can go for
it. No more, I said, I'm going to come and
chuck. I tell a conto comusa,
No banga mukuya kuwa nacho. So
before you
kupunda,
I want you to discuss issues of CDF because it's over celebrated and I want you to put it in context. But before we discuss CDF, I want us to go to a last issue in relation to security. Civil registration. Zambia is in the process of changing its national registration cards. It will no longer be an analog. I think we want to be it to have digital format. But the process in which this has been undertaken, I think, has raised concern. For example, officers from the National Registration Office were in Northwestern, Western, and Southern Province, we understand, for 120 days. Then they've gone to the North, I think, in Luapula and Northern Province, and I think they're only given, is it 40 days? And our people have raised concerns. Is this Why are they attempting to disenfranchise people from, you know, registering for these digital formats of NRC? You were Minister of Home Affairs, and I know that civil registration was very high on your agenda, because when your documents and national identities are proper, your citizens are literally international, because they can be identified, and the issues of identity are very important. But this process can be abused for purposes, for example, of elections. Just speak to this exercise and where we are and the concerns that we have.
But Mambawesu, that issue I've brought is a very important matter. And if we had the chance, and I would still request that if you can just create a another program.
Time.
Another program. We just come and focus on that so that I can give, because being former minister, I would like to give proper insights.
Yeah.
And I would be the last person to just speak on one aspect of the civil registration processes. You recall that when you were representing this country at the AU, I chaired the committee of ministers, AU committee ministers of ministers, on civil registration and vital statistics. You remember that, and we hosted the conference here. And so this is a continental agenda before we zero into to Zambia. It's a continental agenda where we are trying to say that civil registrations must be the anchor of development on the continent, not just Zambia. And how does it anchor the development, because that's the only way you can take stock of all the citizens. Citizens being registered from birth up to the time of death. So you have got this period, and you know, vital statistics of how the citizens are progressing in everything they are doing. Those that have
I recognize that it was also related to the free movement of people protocol.
Precisely.
Because it meant that if someone, for example, if you are opening your borders, persons must be traceable.
Exactly.
So that you secure, you don't allow criminals to take over or abuse the processes.
So it all starts from birth registration. And if you have seen, what used to happen in the past is that birth registration was centralized. Just in the capital of city. Now you can imagine how big Zambia is. To register all bets, it had to be Lusaka. And that's where you had only the registrar for the chief registrar issuing birth certificate. Now look at the population, the way it has grown.
Yeah.
So we needed to decentralize birth registration and digitize it.
Mm.
And I think we must commend UNICEF and other international organizations that have
participated, came
on board to support government.
From political parties, stakeholders, and your citizens, do you think this process is being abused?
I wanted to build up. That's why we need so much time.
Okay.
Because we cannot just talk about NRCs as an isolated aspect.
Okay.
So now what you are talking about is a project called Integrated National Registration and Information System.
Mm.
This is a system which now we are migrating from manual civil registration processes to digitalized platforms of doing civil registration.
Mm.
So what is civil registration? We are talking about birth registration,
NRCs,
death registration, marriages, and whatnot. All those aspects that speak about citizens.
Mm.
So you are doing a paradigm shift. Because what used to happen, Ambassador Mwamba, is that if you got an NRC in Kasama, through the manual processes, you find those receipts piled from 1964, and they are confined in one room. So if you lost an NRC, for them to go and find your record first, that's where you used to see that you have lost an NRC, it takes you maybe 21 days before they could find the records and
find
you because you need to assign someone to go and deep down. So this project entailed that you needed to convert all the manual records into digital format. And once that was done, then you upgrade these data files with now you, Ambassador Mwamba, what are you now? So that what you are now can now go on the onto the system. And the your other details now are put
migrated
so that your details now become part of the Raja National Biometric Database for all citizens. So that every institution that depends on civil registration, identity of citizens, can feed into that.
Banks,
ECZ, the Electoral Commission of Zambia that you have talked about, ZRA, all these are stakeholders. And what we did was to bring all these stakeholders on the table so that they are the role to understand and appreciate what was going to be done. Because mind you, some of these institutions have been defrauded, there have been so many fraud cases where people have, have been,
and
lost
pensions,
pension schemes. Someone goes and gets someone's
benefits
by just
forging
manipulating the current NRCs. So it's a very important project.
We
did a lot of work, you need time. But what I just want to say, because we shall continue on this, it's very key, is to just appeal to the Minister of Home Affairs to demystify this
process. Provide information.
Being transparent. With this ATIE now, which has become law, let citizens understand the processes, what is being done, what is to be achieved, and give accurate information. Because when someone says, we are going to give 20 million NLCs,
that sounds
alarm to the people. We are not yet 20 million. In any case, how many people are above 16?
Only about 10 million.
So that starts bringing confusion. But ideally, it's a project that we left at a very advanced stage.
Okay.
And all we need is information coming from the Minister of Home Affairs to inform the citizens
what that project is all about.
Exactly.
Okay.
So, but we need time to come and basically talk about it and make sure that people understand. We did quite a lot of work as PF. Even as I speak to you, I had my demo card before I left the ministry as minister. Meaning the system was ready to start processing. And in any case, you find that the mother of all ID,
is
the NRC. Now, you have got the driver's licenses.
They that feed on the NRC.
You find the driver's licenses are now generated from the automated systems. It's the same with passports. But the mother of all has remained behind. So I think it's time to make sure that we do. This topic is very critical. Mind you, we also have the issue of passports. You know, there's a deadline that was given in order to change the passports by International Civil Aviation Authority, ICAO. So we want to know how far government has gone.
What's the deadline there?
The deadline is supposed to be this year.
Isn't our passport already digital? We are supposed to add more features?
They need to add more features because I think these are international standards.
Okay.
So when the ICAO, who are responsible for the movement of people through aviation industry, set standards. So if you remain, it's not like the way you were doing the judicial migration of
broadcasting industry.
This one is totally different. If you remain, you just end up one day you're trying to travel and they
and
say
your people cannot travel.
You can't move. So these are issues that again we can speak to in relation to the
civil
issue of
registration,
INRIS, which is a very key project.
Oh, wonderful. Mukalambawandi, CDF, I've heard you in Parliament. I think you were very instrumental in providing the guidelines. President Akainde Hichilema has taken CDF as a centerpiece project. He assumes that it will help in the national development of our country. He has taken it that he's taking both resources and power for local people to design and decide on their own development. What are your feelings about CDF?
Thank you so much, my brother. You know, and thank you so much that you have been following the developments regarding constituency development fund. Mind you, briefly, the genesis of this fund was, was during the movement for Mount Party Democracy.
Yes, under Dr. Chulwa, 1996.
Under
Dr. Chulwa. The first CDF Act of 1996.
Exactly. What motivated members of Parliament to come up with that initiative was the immense challenges that members of Parliament were facing in constituencies with regards to developmental programs. Ideally, central government is to take development to all corners of the country. And so you found that when an MP is elected in an area, in addition to the role as provided in the constitution of being a legislator to provide checks and balances, the issue of advocating for development was now growing. Members of Parliament were seen as channels, as advocates for development on behalf of their electorates. In some cases, the members of the public would be asking, oh, look about that road. The MP has got a limited role. He can only go back to the central government and say, look, here, and dance on the table of the Parliament and say, I want road there. But if there are no funds, it will remain a song. So there were small interventions that members thought they could do, in trying to bridge up the gap. Where there were gaps, like maybe like a crossing point, where people say, oh, MP, we need like a crossing point here. This car road is so bad, we can do the band. So that's how now they said, let's create like a fund, which members of parliament can utilize to as they are waiting for the central government to
implement
development programs. So that's the genesis. And eventually it started growing up until it was institutionalized. Okay? Because initially it was just MP and doing whatever they would, and the accountability was a challenge.
Very low.
It was then institutionalized, and eventually a law passed. We found by the time PF was forming government, it was, I think, about 700,000 kwacha. And then it was doubled for a period of time. Now, we must understand that this was just for interventions, for supplementary efforts
of central government.
Central government at the major role. Because you have seen most of the developmental projects, even the time we had the 1.5 million under PF, Shiwangandu was established as a district with infrastructure beginning. You can you imagine if you had to just depend on CDF?
No, it wouldn't.
Now, what we need to understand, and why people thought some of us were against the CDF, they didn't understand. I had the privilege to serve as minister of local government. And I had the privilege to look at the decentralization policy. Because decentralization policy, Ambassador Mwamba, just entails that devolving government portfolio functions to the lowest, closer to the people, and the channel matching resources to those portfolio functions on the ground. That's what decentralization tells. Now, you cannot implement decentralization in a piecemeal.
Yeah.
What we are trying to do is trying to implement decentralization in the piecemeal, using CDF as a channel. No, and that's why I argued that CDF cannot be a panacea to the development gaps that we have on the in the rural areas, for example. Now, what we are seeing now are challenges that I spoke to. I told my colleagues, I said, you can be excited by the huge figures, but how much capacity do your local authorities have
to even absorb this?
To absorb these funds? And you need competent officers to ensure that the funds are spent timely and effectively. Go to construction, for example. What does it take to construct a clinic? You need engineers. You need electrical engineers. You need all these competences. You need clerks of works who should monitor the works, because the contractor would want to maximize on profits.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter whether they do a short work.
And standards
can
be compromised.
So you need to have professionals to monitor all that. So now, even when you see people being measured, and I've seen MPs panicking, especially my new colleague MPs. How do you panic
when you're
measuring? When you're measuring,
speak to the Ben Red, because last week that was the major story. Information was released that certain constituencies were doing far better than others. What is this Ben Red?
Again, the problem we have.
What, for example, didn't Shuangandu use to achieve a burn rate of 90% or 92%.
Again, Rashman, but this is where I say
Londoraland.
We refer to a talent and sharing of ignorance. Knowledge is very important.
Yeah.
And we need to explain to our people the way things are lined up. When I was talking about decentralization, I was saying it's taking portfolio functions, government services closer to the people. Now, the challenge we have is that you lump money into the CDF. Okay? The central government, which is headed by a district commissioner, who supervises education, DEPSI, DHO, district health office, agriculture and all
community
these other
development,
departments,
sports,
are now looking to local government. Okay? Now, if you look at the law, the MP, area member of parliament, is part of what we call Constituency Development Committee. What's the role of the Constituency Development Committee? Is to receive submissions from ward development committees in the wards where people stay.
Yeah.
Where they say, here in our ward, we want a clinic to be built. They've agreed. Consensus. Submit to the CDF committee. The CDF committee will say, yes, this is good. And the MP, who is the area member of parliament, is part of this committee where there are other members. And he's not the one who is to chair that committee according to the law.
Yeah.
There's a chairperson and other members where you deliberate and approve projects. And the Minister of Local Government has encouraged committees to approve projects in the first quarter of the year. When these projects are approved, where are they taken? To the implementing agents, which is the local authority. The local authority does everything. They are the ones who assess the cost of the project. They are the ones who should procure the project. They are the ones who should award the project and monitor it until it is finished.
Yeah.
It's all local government to implement. And so when you see the controlling officer, local government, saying this constituency has not done this. Mm. They are not being sincere.
Yeah.
Because they
are the implementers.
Are the implementers through the local authorities. Mm. Their principal officers, who are town clerks and council secretaries, are the ones that implement on behalf of the committee.
The MP can't implement.
No, even when you are saying burning rate, you are assessing a local authority.
Mm.
Because the role of the CDF committee ends up at approving projects. Kwa mana, you can't go and tell a procurement officer in the council and say, you, can you make sure that you procure this today?
Mm.
Make sure you procure desks today. No. Mm. So the challenge lies in the local government service commission ensuring that they
provide capacity.
Human capital to local authorities, competences, all the competences, technical and otherwise, so that these people can be able to execute the projects on time.
Mm.
So when you are they're booting those rates, they're just rating themselves as local government.
Mm. Mm.
Because even MPs who are banking, I laugh at them.
But let me give an example. For example, Shangombo was at 92%, and Lusaka City, Lusaka Central, which is in town, which is under Lusaka City Council, where all the competences are available, was at, 27%? What does that mean?
Again, it comes to these structures that I'm talking about. If, for example, the constituency office, which has got only four members of staff, actually. Those are the members of staff that you find at the constituency office. Professional assistant and an office assistant, then two guards. That's all for a member of parliament. And these are just basically to deal with parliamentary work, administration, and whatnot. They have got no role to play in whatsoever
in implementing
CDF projects. You understand?
So your assertions are very clear. This doesn't, it's not MPs that have been exposed.
No, not at all. Even when you are saying, Mandevu Constituency or Lusaka Central, Lusaka Central can approve. And this I'm saying, I'm not even being partisan.
Yeah.
I've been a longer serving member of parliament. And some of the things that have made us being dear to the people are the projects that we were doing, even under the small CDF. Because people were able to see what's being done. And then central government was also doing their works, road networks were being opened at that time. You understand? Now, the challenge is structural. When we want to implement, let's implement decentralization policy to the full. Then there will be no this jostling of, oh, now let's bring the DC into the CDF committee. It will improve nothing. It will just brought the committee and the little allowances that people are given for sitting, it will just be wasted for nothing. So let's deal with structural changes. Let's capacitate the local authorities to have the human capital needed to implement. Here where we've got more than one constituency, for example, and then you want to be DC to be part of these committees. He has to sit in Matero, go to Chawama, go to Mande. All these are just things that we are duplicating. Let's go back to the decentralization policy, implement it in its totality. Then all this drama will go. Because now this is a little basket that sits at the district and everybody is looking there. And I'm fearing for most of the members of parliament. It's tempting. I've heard some others are even getting their wives registered in cooperatives.
Yes, and
there's one constituency.
There's a constituency where an MP gave his wife empowerment fund.
Yes, and they were. I saw some karate, karate being experienced in. Is it on the copper belt? Mpongwe, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, but again, members of parliament must understand their role. That it's corruption of the highest order. Some of us have lived this much and you can never find any in our names anywhere near the Auditor General's report. Why? Because we understand our role. And members of parliament should understand their role. They should lessen the temptation of thinking that they can benefit because they're coming from the ruling party. Time will catch up with them. You know, so it's important that we deal with the structural changes. So those who are even competing, oh, this percentage, what this? What are you basing that on? Who are you rating? And so the issue of CDF for me, if you had to ask me, I would rather you left a little amount of money for the supplementary interventions. Let all these
take the resources to the local authority.
Exactly. Means of education. Are you saying means of education cannot account for money if you give them money? Are you saying means of wealth cannot account for money to build a clinic if you give them money to build the clinic? And the minister, the role of the MP then becomes effectively to ensure that these resources are being applied. And now you want to eat, to go with both hands. You want to be an implementer of mine, and then you offer oversight function on yourself. It doesn't work.
I've always said that there's a mistaken belief, I think, by the president, if you hear him speak, where he thinks CDF is decentralization policy.
That's what the challenge
yet is. Yet CDF is just a small component in the decentralization policy.
Precisely.
Mkalambwanda, as we wind up the program, ninchwana mkwata kabai election kshuangandu, file ndashani fintu.
By election, first of all, it's a concern that we have. The ruling party, I don't know what they're trying to prove. You know, and this thing of deceiving yourselves and thinking that, oh, by causing these by-elections, inducing by-elections, and then you go and buy voters and win one, you think you are gaining popularity. You are cheating yourselves, and these DCs, who are supposed to be working now, they are busy.
They are being
you
deployed.
Can imagine how much DCs are kuisoka, banning fuel, your government.
No,
with impunity to go and start campaigning in these by-elections. It's a waste of resources. If you are working, people will love you and will vote for you. You don't have to go and buy them. You can't believe that the young man who was a councillor was made to leave the job of being councillor. I know his age and I've been part of the security cluster. There was no way he could have qualified to be an officer of Zambia National Service. I don't know what has been criteria was used.
They're abusing abusing public infrastructure.
That's it.
I was looking at the new set of ward elections that are coming up. All of them are saying, I've resigned, I've joined Ministry of Health, Ministry of Education. Like you are saying, they want to create this artificial popularity in the north. And it appears that these councillors are all from Luapula, Northern Muchinga provinces. You mean there is no councillor residing from the UPND?
They are trying to show that they are making inroads. But you see, these have been done before, and you cannot deceive people.
Yeah.
So for me, those that are doing those maneuvers are really just what you can imagine. People have not received fertilizer. Then you go to take them a by election, and you want to give them handouts for a period of 30 days. After that, they go back to the same poverty.
Yeah. What have you done?
You know, so for me, these by-elections are just a waste of resources. But we have explained to people that Muleria, Umutawa Weshiruku Ombola, Nidadi Penene, Pantutama Kafimonena Kavidi, Awalisa Kamonekana Kavidi, Kanshikudia, Yero Mabe Wokuta, we are not fools that we want to work with Lapo. Ever to have women, you know, we come from opposition.
Yeah.
We have just gone back to opposition. So if in 20 fish, we know some. So today we have focus on looking after people. People want social cash transfer to Balafola. Umufundo, Bantuvalea, Kanama Meda. You know, production, Yara, put punch. Then we go to a point of by election. Quite about Fulungana. After the phone from Mufundo, one Meda, one way to a little by election. Neda, I'm sure I didn't get over Mufundo. So, when you done.
Denying their own
politics. focus on your role.
Mm-hmm.
You are civil mm-hmm. servants.
Yeah.
And if you want people to start taking things in their hands, you'll be shocked. Don't think people are stupid.
So we put it on record. If they deployed some DCs from the districts into Shwangando.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. DC Soka, DC Chinsali, DC Shwangando, DC
Mukampeni.
Na mumpika sentro chimochine. Kaile eka nilo nomba wa DC. Hello mwana wa DC baba tola wa kutata iswa nchito ya DC nishi.
Yeah.
So vena kumana kwa chinga washa na sana muri wala tukafwe wa sarafwe wa MP imbero wake sawa kwa ma MPs. Namba tule kwa mkana na wapantu wa lisho kwe wati uchenjeshu wangu koko.
Pungwa tasakamana. Thank you very much Honorable Stephen Kampyongo. Jet Li, we call him Jet Li. With those remarks, I'd like to end this program and to thank you so much.
But Mwamba,
Mkwai.
Kwa kofi ya wadu kutipaka kishe mishipi. Pantu wapature ya uchushi wena kwa wala wako.
Wala moneka ya.
Uchushi wala wako. Pakuti ya kabunga ta tule ingila mure ni season ni kaya mli 400 kwacha. Kaisi ni kako mishipi. Bana mawe muka kishe fitenge. Vya wale la ndatumwa ichafu minoko wale musunina ayo kwa Tuale miwa. No, but you are seeing for yourselves. Guy man wanga tuleta politiki.
Yeah.
So those who are right now unga matume kwa timudi baruano. Mumu kushumu. Inzala abantu wale la dila mango. Bashimwa bate kwa ngala hiyo.
Aona kadia.
Tema politics.
Awe.
Tema politics.
No, you can't politic with lies.
Let's feed people. Nombe inzala ilipo kwa wana kolela mtu ngaisa promise ya fe once.
Kufwa.
Kunsala nensala ajibane nsala ni koni. So wabantu mwaramu nifu wala famuli uwele kwa kole. Lava mayo wa siuvia masebo. Na mubomba muma tekwa enge hayi chine chine. Don't pretend to be the most UPND. Which you just joined 2 years ago. Respect the professional medical officers. Respect them. Don't antagonize them. When we say there are no medicines in the hospital, understand that there are no medicines. Do the right job.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yonga mambo kulandiri ashi na jetli tetiripwe. Kithia kulanda firafula. I'll bring you back on the issue of civil registration and NRCs. This has concerned our people. I think it requires a lot of time. And to all those that joined us today, thank you very much for your support and your commitment. Until we have another guest, good day.